What makes you such a better personal trainer than, let's say, the next person I go to at the gym, assuming you guys have the same knowledge? And it's a fantastically valid question.
I am here today with Lee Boyce. Lee, thank you so much for joining me. How are you doing?
I'm doing great. I'm doing great out here. It's been a busy morning, so I'm glad to sort of wind things down and have a good talk.
Awesome. Well, thanks for squeezing us in. I know you're very busy and in demand. So I came across your work a long time ago, but I sort of think of you as the anthropometry guy. And I'm glad I said that word and didn't screw it up. But if you could kind of run us through what anthropometry is and why it's important in strength training to kick off, please.
So anthropometry pertains to pretty much your proportions from a skeletal perspective, you know, the length of your arms, the length of your torso, the length of your legs, even within those different limbs, like the length of your femur versus the length of your tibia, things like that. And so just how no two bodies are necessarily identically the same. And so anthropometry, it has a real reach into what it can do to affect the decisions we make for strength training or for weight training in general, for any kind of training. And also how different kinds of training and different programs and different methods that we use in training can affect us with our anthropometry. So it's sort of they serve both each other in a way. And we've got to be careful to know exactly what choices to make in order for our training longevity and our healthy bodies to be preserved, both of those cases. And so that's something that I'm quite passionate about. And I've never really been coined the anthropometry guy before, but I'll take it.
Well, it's the first time for everything, but I only say that because you literally wrote the book with, is it Melody Schoenfeld? Is that
Melody Schoenfeld? Yeah, my co-author. And so we were working on that for a good couple of years before it came to fruition. We met back in 2019 at the Kansas City Fitness Summit. And from that point, we became friends. We did some work together. We did collabos on Instagram and other places like that. And then finally, we started working on the book. And it was quite harmonious, especially considering that she's definitely more of a researchy junkie than I am. And so we sort of like, we were yin and yang for one another. And so it was really perfect. And it came together 15 chapters and just under 300 pages. So it's a good thorough look with medical illustrations and all kinds of stuff. It's a really good thorough look at as many body types as we could possibly put together and different exercises that correspond to those body types, programming choices that correspond to those body types, and so on. So yeah, we're glad to have it out there. And it's sort of the only kind of product out there that sort of deals with that subject matter. So we're happy that it's unique and that it sort of stands alone.
Yeah, it's certainly the only one that I'm aware of that is that sort of comprehensive. And that it's very, you know, I can say this as someone with a PhD, it's very academically rigorous and academically credible. And also, I think it works quite well because you're really tall, right? 6'4", 6'5", and she's quite small in stature.
Yeah. I'm 6'4", and then she's 5 feet. So yeah, we have we're walking examples of just the diversity that does exist from an anthropometry perspective, for one, and you know, the individual struggles but also triumphs or strengths and weaknesses that we might experience from being on different sides of the spectrum when it comes to strength training and the things that we'd have to endure because of that.
And I think it's really useful to have a good understanding of this, because it's not just training athletes, as you said, it's members of the public. It's that there's a lot there that can help, because people will think of, you know, extremes, right? They'll think of like basketball players versus maybe gymnasts or something. But it's not just, and you mentioned this earlier, but it's not just necessarily height. It's, you know, limb length proportionate to height and all that sort of stuff that's factored into it, right?
And that's the thing, right? Like if somebody is checking out my stuff on Instagram, for example, they might see that every Tuesday I make a post called Tall Guy Tuesdays. And that pertains mainly to either very tall lifters or very big lifters. But at the same time, every couple of times a year or so, I try to make a point to make a post on that Tuesday post to say, hey, just in case you're wondering, this is not just for 6'8" lifters who are male, right? I have a female client. She's in her 60s and she is 5'10". So by national averages, she's tall for a woman, but at the same time, she's not tall as far as an overall height goes, just as a human being. You know, she's not 6'8" or something like that. But what she does have is super long arms and legs and a very short torso. And so all of the principles that I apply to the tall guys and like that sort of stuff for the 6'8" lifters and whatnot, they apply completely to her as well. So it really has to do with, again, anthropometry and just your limb length and your proportions. And that could mean a whole lot of good can be taken from, you know, not only the contents of the book, but the contents of the Tall Guy Tuesdays and whatnot. It's all about looking at the proportions from a different perspective and realizing that you got to find the right shoe to fit.
Absolutely, yeah. And I think that to have those sort of tools in the toolbox and that more detailed understanding, it's only going to help, you know, with your own training, if you're just interested in training yourselves, and, you know, if you're a training clients, that's going to be super helpful for that. So let's dig into it a little bit. There's some sort of obvious examples that I can think of. Like, if you happen to have very long arms, you're probably not going to be super set up for, you know, bench press or overhead press, but you might be very good at deadlifting. Right. You know, and the reverse, if you're going to have T-Rex arms or very short arms, I should say, you might be better at bench pressing and it might be harder to deadlift. So I was wondering if you could kind of run through some sort of considerations that you first, when you look at someone, when you take on a client, you know, first, how you kind of gauge things, I guess. And second, say, let's start off with someone like you with, you know, long arms, long legs, long levers, tall, where you'd kind of go with programming and what perhaps you might not program and what you perhaps would program.
Okay, so generally speaking, I have somebody who's got, you know, longer extremities and they're maybe taller overall, then I know right away that it's probably going to be a little bit of a harder step forward to make major progress with your classic barbell movements. We do have to do some kind of adjustment if possible. And even if their form is fantastic, even if they have the mobility, even if they have all of those things in place and their form looks good and maybe they're strong with it too, great. But I would still make considerations from a programming perspective in terms of how much of that I do place into their program. And the reason why is because if we look at things from a physics perspective and we think about work and what that defines itself as, work is the product of force and distance. So the amount of loading, cumulatively speaking, that a person who's 6'10" is going to have to go through sets of 10 back squats, for example, assuming there's full range of motion achieved, it's going to be more taxing than somebody who's 5'6" doing the same thing with relatively the same amount of weight that's comparable to what they're capable of, right? And so that work is going to be a lower expenditure for them, and it's going to mean that their recovery time is going to need less of it. They're going to be shorter recovery time, and they're probably going to not need to make as many, I guess, mobility-based compensations in order to achieve the ranges of motion too. In other words, how far over their toes do their knees have to travel for the anterior translation in order for them to get the proper balance for the bar to be over the middle of the foot where it belongs when they're squatting down to the bottom, right? Even if a person who's 6'10" has the mobility to do that, that's a very, very far knee over toe position, which relies on tons of dorsiflexion, which also means a lot of taxation on the knees for the better or for the worse. So it's one thing to be able to access ranges of motion. How you access those ranges of motion is what needs to be put into closer, identification or closer consideration. And why that's so important is because if I'm working with a client who does have proportions like that, the first thing that I'm going to think of, okay, is what's the volume that you have of movements that might be better or more designed for a shorter lifter, right? Or for a lifter with shorter arms or whatever have you, right? You know, I'm a guy who's got pretty respectable numbers, all things considered, when it comes to the squat, deadlift, bench, right? And I'm not a slouch when it comes to those three movements. But at the same time, if I was to try to do a German volume training workout, which is 10 sets of 10 of back squats, with only 60 seconds of rest in between, I know that I'm going to need more rest than the guy who's 5'7", right? And it's because of that whole work thing that I was talking about. And so it's like, do I sort of balance out that risk reward by going that route? Or maybe do I choose something else that's going to be better suited for a person like me, leverages like me, size like me, right? And so that's what I try to consider is I look at that person, I look at the body, look at the levers, the proportions, and then I look at it from more of a macro perspective and think about, okay, how much are we going to deep dive into these kinds of movements? We can still do them, but maybe not as much as the next person. And how are we going to supplement them by maybe doing these kinds of movements instead to better service their body and keep them able to do this long term?
Yeah. So in terms of sort of movement patterns, you might sort of still do that, say, you know, hip hinge pattern, but with a different implement, for example, right? In that case of the tall lifter, because it's still going to be important to do that sort of foundational pattern, but yep, not necessarily with a straight barbell, right?
Exactly. So it's like you still look at the categories. And, you know, it's funny because yesterday I was just teaching a lab, and the categories for we were talking about program design and programming with regards to hip dominant, knee dominant patterns, horizontal pushes, horizontal pulls, vertical pushes, vertical pulls. And this is what you want to consider when you're arranging a program in terms of just what umbrellas everything should fit underneath. And now it's a matter of plugging and playing the right choices for the right client. And so with that being said, looking at things from a principles perspective rather than making hard and fast rules and realizing, okay, if we can kind of just at least attack each one of these categories, then the world's our oyster in terms of what choice we use by way of the exercise in particular. And that's going to fit and suit the client best. So if you've got a client 6'10" who wants to do a hip dominant pattern, does that mean we have to do barbell deadlifts from the floor? Well, there's hip thrusts, there's reverse hypers, there's trap bar deadlifts, there's barbell rack pulls. There's a million other opportunities for different movements that you can use that are going to be better for what those demands are going to be placing on the person's body, especially their spine in that case.
Yeah. And as you said, that even if, for example, in your case, even if you can do it in a relatively mechanically sound way, doesn't necessarily mean that you should do it, right? And I think a theme that's come across, I've done a lot of interviews, and you know, that just there aren't mandatory exercises, right? There's right. always going to be maybe movement patterns that you want to include, but the exercises themselves are very much, you know, you don't have to be doing proper strength training, you don't have to back squat. Like it's more kind of more complex than that.
Yeah. And the better that we can get at realizing or ascertaining this earlier on in our training journey, in our training life, it just means more longevity for us as far as not being older and really beat up from the gym. If you talk to any person, and this transcends body types at this point, if you talk to any person who's in fantastic shape, or at least visually looking really great, and they're like 75 years old, and you see them in the gym, and they're there, and you ask them, hey, what have you been up to for the last like 40 years to be looking like this and to be performing like this at this age? They're not going to reply to you. I can guarantee they're not going to reply to you by saying, oh, you know, I just hit my deadlifts every week. I hit my squats every week. I try to push that 90%. I'm on this program. No. Chances are many of the times that's sort of happened in my case, I found that the person who replies says their goals have changed over the years. They place more of a focus or emphasis on movements that, you know, fit their bodies best and what they respond well to so they can keep on doing it. And they have much more of a focus on two things, especially cardiorespiratory training and mobility work, right? And so making sure that those two things are on point as well, it makes for a healthy inside and outside for the person. And of course, they're going to hit the weights, they're doing their weights and so on, but they know their bodies so well by this point that their training IQ, their intuition about training has reached a certain point where, okay, dips are something that is bothersome to me. So instead, I'm going to choose a different thing for my chest and triceps. Or deadlifts, you know what? I'm not going to do them with a barbell anymore. I'm going to go dumbbell RDLs, and I'm going to supplement that with other stuff as well. If I go heavy, it's going to be on a day where I feel really great. If not, I'm going to keep it in this rep range because this speaks to me in a great way, et cetera, et cetera. And these are almost a series of personal decisions that a person needs to make based on their own time and experience. But they're important ones to make when the time comes for it.
Yeah. And I think it's important to remember, you mentioned it there, but everybody's kind of individual mileage is going to vary a lot, right? Especially if they've had a sports background, for example, or a particular injury history. So when people, because I see a lot with young coaches that they'll sort of think, oh, well, you've got to do the big three and you've got to be really kind of focused on getting strong in a 5-rep range. You're like, well, yeah, but not necessarily for everybody, right? There are all sorts of ways of expressing strength. And I think another thing that you mentioned as well is that the older you are, perhaps you get away with a bit less volume on certain things to maintain that strength. And then you can kind of prioritize other qualities and then come back around and, you know, not necessarily having too many conflicting goals, as it were.
Yeah. I'm not some old person, but at the same time, even with me comparing my current self to, let's say, myself at 25 or 23, it's a major difference in terms of the way that I treat those movements like the squat or the deadlift, how often I do it, how heavy I go, what makes me want to actually pursue a really heavy effort for that day. Most of the time, I'm not doing that sort of thing. Most of the time, I'm training in a way that's going to serve my body and not maybe even narrowly escape an injury, for example, right? And that's what I found myself in a habit of doing lots of times when I was squatting or deadlifting was, okay, yeah, I hit four whatever or five or 380 with a squat or something like that. But it's like, I could feel that I'm just one move away from, okay, there goes my back again type of thing, right? So it's like, why even risk it? Why not, if you squat, maybe you squat 200 and call it a day, or instead push yourself really hard on two other big movements that aren't the squat because they don't bother you, right? So there's nothing wrong with pushing hard on a heavy split squat or pushing hard on some lunges or pushing hard on a leg press or on a hack squat or whatever have you. And so that way you can still get that output and still have a productive workout by whatever your standards are, but you're staying in the safe territory with movements that are good to you. And that way you can do it again the next week and so on.
And it's almost sort of more immediately obvious when we're thinking about strength training, but different body types, there are going to be implications for, you know, all sorts of cardiovascular training, for example, calisthenics and those sorts of things. I was wondering if you could kind of give us a sort of quick overview of considerations in, you know, different body types when it comes to cardio and other forms of exercise.
Yeah, so speaking from firsthand, I guess, talking about bigger bodies especially, which is interesting because it's a talk that I'm going to be giving with Melody over at CanFit Pro in Toronto next month. In August, we're going to talk about strength training for the bigger body. But this is an interesting one because we're talking about things like cardio or talking about conditioning work and whatnot. You know, the amount of energy that it just takes to simply run a body that is larger, whether it's somebody who is higher in body fat or somebody who's very muscular and just a big person, that's going to be a bigger ask for certain people when it comes to high intensity cardio work, conditioning stuff. If I was to take a person who is a client who's my size and make them do a Tabata workout, which is 20 seconds of work to 10 seconds of rest, repeated 8 times, even though there's not too much weight that's involved in lifting that, they're going to be on their backs after set number 3, you know? And something we have to recognize is that even if from a scientific perspective, things should be sort of like an even playing field, it doesn't work that way in the real world. So there's stuff that looks great in theory and things that look great on paper, but then there's stuff where in practice and in execution, you have to realize there are going to be curveballs that are thrown at you. And in the case of a lot of programming that's out there, the considerations for the size of the individual usually aren't even there. They should be, because as soon as we add that in, as soon as we factor that in, the entire spectrum, the entire sort of landscape will change in terms of what choices you make. What supersets are you going to choose? How long are the rest intervals? A program could never tell you that when it's fixed and you just took it off of a book or out of the internet or whatnot. It'll never be able to know what the starting point is of the individual or who they're talking to. And so that's the benefit of actually working with someone in person, first and foremost, and having something that's more customized at your disposal if you can. But more importantly, if you are somebody who has, you know, a larger body than somebody else, then don't give yourself too much flack for not being able to perform at the same level if you haven't rested as much or if you've rested the same amount as the next person has, because you probably need more rest than that. And, you know, another thing to recognize is that smaller people are going to have more relative strength and bigger people are going to have more absolute strength. Brushing that with broad strokes, of course, but in general, that's a great sort of principle to remember, right? And so as far as things like, okay, are you going to get a guy my size to go and crack out 50 pull-ups? No, it's not going to happen, right? Are you going to get somebody who's the size of a gymnast to crack out 50 pull-ups? Far more likely. Now change that, and absolute strength, that the strongest deadlift that's ever been recorded is not going to be by a person who's 180 pounds, right? It's not going to be by a person who's 5'7" and 180 pounds, right? They'll have more relative strength, so they may be able to do that 4 times their body weight. But that 1,100-pound deadlift or whatever, it's going to be by a big person, right? And mass moves mass. So it's just a good thing for people to remember and remind themselves of that you're going to display and express different strengths of your athleticism, different strengths of your fitness from all the different components of it in certain areas. And then a person with a different body is going to develop and exploit different strengths of their fitness in other certain areas. And that's just how it goes. That's the beauty of it all.
And it's interesting, you know, if you look at the extreme examples, it becomes more obvious, right? As you mentioned, and I've heard you say this before, but like, there's a reason that the top CrossFit competitors aren't 6'5". And there's a reason also, I suppose, that, you know, someone in the NBA, you're unlikely to make it if you're 5'7", right? Whereas for CrossFit, and, you know, you're doing tons of pull-ups or tons of dips or whatever, it's going to be a lot easier. That's the sort of thing, I suppose, people need to bear in mind. So even if it looks the same on paper, it's not actually the same in reality. You mentioned the distance piece, but it's literally more work.
Yep. So like with CrossFit, is a great example, because with CrossFit, you're moving an implement and time is the deciding factor. In the CrossFit games, whoever crosses the line first, having done all of these different feats of athleticism, are the people who win. And so if you're going to be tasked with the responsibility of doing, let's say, 100 kettlebell snatches and 50 power cleans and then 100 front squats, all under X amount of minutes or all in the shortest time that you can, I'm just using an example, like, why would somebody think the person with the longest distance to travel is going to finish earlier than a person who has a shorter distance to travel? It's as simple as that. And so when you take just the basic laws of the universe and you put that into the factor, then it really changes the landscape in terms of which athletes will probably have, and I won't say advantage, but will be at a better starting point than somebody else, right? And so if you look at CrossFit athletes, I think at the time that I wrote the book with Melody, it was the last 5 years with the CrossFit competitors, I believe the average height was 5'8" or 5'9" for the male winners. And, you know, Rich Froning, who won like however many in a row, he's like 5'9" or 5'8". Matt Frazier, who's even shorter. There's a lot of people who are in that sort of echelon. And like, you have to go back pretty far to find somebody who's over 6 feet tall, who's in that category with them, right? So it really speaks a lot to, dependent on what the discipline is, there are going to be strengths and weaknesses from whatever body type you have. And when you get to an elite level of anything, you're going to start seeing much more of a homogeneous group when it comes to body types and when it comes to anthropometry. If you look at elite swimmers, if you look at elite sprinters, if you look at elite running backs in football, you name the exercise or the sport, sorry, and you're going to see that sort of thing. And, you know, I'm grateful to have had track and field as my background because as a sprinter and having been coached as a sprinter and a long jumper, it's strictly all that the whole thing is based around is learning how to adapt yourself to the physics of moving efficiently through space. So you could get there first or you could hurdle yourself through the air the furthest, right? And so just having that baseline of training behind me, it allows me to understand these concepts pretty well. And I'm glad that I was able to experience it firsthand as well.
Yeah, I think having that, the athletic background is obviously going to help when, you know, training athletes, but it's also going to help when training general, you know, population. I think that's very useful. And it's also useful, your academic background, right? I know you've written, I think, upwards of 1,300 academic articles, but articles for different, you know, outlets.
Yep.
And also, as you mentioned earlier, you know, you're teaching at a college, and I think it's health promotion. That's a neat segue into my next kind of question, relating to kind of how to be a good coach or how to be a good personal trainer. So if you have, you know, a lot of what I'd call book knowledge, you know, you have a lot of good understanding of this theory of it, right? That's not the whole picture. So I think you've talked about a 60-40 split, for example, in terms of like communication versus the actual content you provide, or perhaps your knowledge. It's what you're able to communicate that matters. So I was wondering if you'd kind of expand on that. I know we have a lot of aspiring coaches and coaches listening. So I think that'd be really useful to hear your thoughts on that as someone with a big track record.
The first thing, like, there's so many layers to this subject right here, and communication, like, I've been asked that question before, even by members of my family, where they'll say something along the lines of, so like, what is kind of like a key or a secret or like a little answer to being good at this to the point where you are, you know, accumulating respect from people and whatnot? And what makes you such a better personal trainer than, let's say, the next person I go to at the gym, assuming you guys have the same knowledge? And it's a fantastically valid question. And my answer, I had to think about it, but my answer was, the key to me to being an effective trainer is to be a great communicator. If you have that under your belt, if you have that on your side, then even if your knowledge level isn't as good as the next trainers, you still might be busier and be a better all-around trying to, you know, a trainer sort of type of thing. And, you know, it's a counterintuitive way to think, but it's true. Communication, and not only necessarily what it is that you choose to say, but how you choose to say it, it matters so much, not only in terms of making sure that you know how to cue and coach and things from an actual theoretical or a, you know, practical gym standpoint, training standpoint, but also from the standpoint of building rapport with a client and finding similar grounds that you guys can both stand on that's going to make you like each other and continue to like each other and have them build more buy-in in working with you so they look forward to your sessions. One thing that is very important to do, I believe, is to be able to not be a disingenuous self, but be somebody who in a genuine way can wear different hats from one client to the next, because people are going to have different things they're interested in. People are going to have different ways of joking around. People are going to have different ways of responding to motivation. Knowing what hat to wear with whom and still making it a genuine part of yourself is going to be huge. And that sounds, and listen, I've been asked that question before where it's like, well, if you're going to be two different hats or wear five different hats over the course of a day when you have five clients, which is the real you? You're faking it. And it's like, no, I'm not. One reason why one person might think that a person would be faking that would be if they have a very narrow scope or narrow breadth of, I guess, life or world experience. When I say that, I just mean, what are your interests? Is it strictly training? Or are you getting hobbies? Are you checking out other stuff? Are you going to the movies and finding other stuff to do? Are you playing some sports? Are you checking out music? Are you reading the new, whatever it is, right? Are you reading fiction? If you increase that, those horizons in terms of amount of things that you just show general interest in, then the world's your oyster as far as what kind of clients are going to end up liking you, because now you're going to have more things to talk about, to relate to have an opinion on, to go back and forth about, to ask about, etc. Right. And, you know, I like saying the term that it's a really great thing to be able to know a little about a lot. And that's what I pride myself personally on kind of having achieved by this point, is try to know a little about a lot rather than knowing a lot about a little. And that can go a long way for somebody in this game, because this game is all about relationships.
Yeah. And as you said, it means you can communicate with anybody. It means that you can relate to different people. Yeah, I can see a lot of value in that. So in terms of kind of communication style, and I see mistakes a lot with young trainers, for example, they're very keen, and I know you've had this question before, they're very keen to show off their knowledge. So they'll talk about, you know, moment arms and hypertrophy and, you know, force velocity curves. And that's great. And it's good to have an understanding of all that sort of stuff. But unless the client's really into it or was an athlete or whatever, it's going to leave them kind of cold, right? They're just going to be like, yeah, sure. It's relating to them, as you said, and even cueing them in a way that they can understand. So I was wondering if you kind of explain a little bit more about that. As someone who does understand, obviously, all the biomechanics, you have a kinesiology degree, but also is able to sort of say, well, you don't want to abduct your humerus. You know, you've got to be more in ways they can understand.
So what I like to say is that when it comes to the big, deep, like esoteric knowledge, most of the time, you're not going to end up using it or needing to use it directly, right? It's a big flex for a lot of young trainers who might just be close to being out of school or whatever their case is, or they just learned or they just got a certification by a pretty intense certification program or whatever. So then all of a sudden, or maybe they just studied stuff, the industry specific stuff where they're reading T Nation all the time or they're reading this or that. And that's all fine. And they're checking up the latest research and studies. They have to understand when they can apply this stuff and when they can't, when they shouldn't. Most of the time, they won't need to and they don't really have to and they shouldn't. If you can take subject matter and be able to dumb it down to the point where a 10-year-old or a 5-year-old can understand what you're saying about that very complex subject, well, that's a different conversation. I do that all the time. right? Whether it's talking about energy systems utilization or whatever it is that the subject is, like having a client understand why they're doing something that might seem simple, but actually has a bigger picture as a motive behind it, that can be good. And it in and of itself can build some buy-in right there, right? But it's all about how you present that information to the client. I used to be in the rabbit hole of getting very, very deep with the science and the thinking that that would impress clients first and foremost. And second of all, thinking that the clients were more advanced than they were and that they needed things that were less simplistic than they did. And in both cases, it was a mistake. So these days, it's like, okay, could I go back and forth with somebody who wants to talk science and talk about the kinematics of this or that? Sure, but why? You know, it's not necessarily needed. So I'd rather play it a little bit more simplistic and just play that game instead, and it goes just fine. If clients have questions, then by all means, you can answer, be thorough, but be simplistic with the answer too at the same time.
You spent a long time on the gym floor. You're one of the few trainers who has always maintained, you know, a gym floor presence. You've always maintained that practice over, what is it, 16, 17 years now?
Yeah, 17 going on 18.
Yeah, despite, you know, having written a lot of articles, having written a book, despite teaching at a college. So you must see a lot of kind of younger trainers, and kind of what are the big mistakes that you see them making, I suppose, in terms of communication, but you can go more broadly if you want, that you would, maybe I would have made them, maybe you would have made them 10 years ago that you wouldn't make now.
So I think that the first one would probably be forgetting about, There's a point where you have to realize the human factor of this whole training thing, right? And so clients, for the most part, well, they're not athletes. A lot of the clients aren't going to be athletes that we work with if we're working with the general population. But beyond that, they care about all of this stuff when it comes to their workouts. At the most, they care about it the most when they're in front of their trainer. And that doesn't mean that I'm trying to give them a slight or anything like that. I'm not saying that. I'm saying they have lives to live and careers that aren't our career. And so because of that, the most attention that they're ever going to give things like their fitness and health is probably going to come at the time that they're working with you while they're in front of you, right? Now, they might be mindful of their diet. They might be mindful of their rest and their sleep and stuff, but that's not number one priority for them. If they're 48 years old with a 50-hour per week job and two kids at home and a family to deal with and all that stuff, and, you know, other things, their parents might be a little bit getting up in age and ill and things like that, they have other things to worry about, right? They got to go out to the cottage. They got to take the kids to soccer. They got to do this and that. This is just how it goes. And so they're getting their workouts in at the same time, and they do have goals, but it's, let me put it this way. If something was to hit the fan and things were to go a little bit wrong or go south for them, I can guarantee in 90% of the cases with the general population, the first thing to go from their palate would be personal training and the luxury that is working with a trainer to help them exercise. They'd stop. And so with that in mind, we have to recognize that when it comes to things like, the last minutia of tracking numbers or goals or this program and how intense we make it, staying married to certain percentages and whatever else, we could take a step back from that. And we can realize that if we don't speak their language first and foremost, and realize that if this isn't as important to them, we do have a responsibility for keeping an accountability there, but also realizing that human factor and realizing that we can deviate from certain strictures of a program, or we can apply a little bit of things that might be meeting them halfway in terms of what they want to do as well as what they need as well. So if we can do that and we can pull that off successfully, it's probably going to result in a longer term client than the opposite. Now, it doesn't mean being completely lax and not a good trainer, for lack of a better term. It doesn't mean stopping being good at what you do or using your knowledge in a proper way. But it does mean realizing that this is a two-way street of being human here, right? And, these clients might not be training for the next Olympics or anything like that. And if they're just training for life and they're just training for, you know, look good, feel good, which is the goals of 80% of general population people. If it's one of those two things or both of them, look good, feel good, or feel good, look good, whatever order you want to put it in, then it can help us take our, you know, just let our shoulders down a little bit and just relax and train them in a healthy manner that is not going to overwhelm them, that's not going to create pressure or make exercise and training another stressor in their life. And, you know, we could take it easy. So that's number one. Number two, another thing that is a mistake, would definitely go back to what we were just talking about being too technical all the time, or overshooting what, or overestimating what a client's capabilities or needs are. So that gets different. When we're overestimating what a client's needs or demands are, it means, are we training a client like they're an athlete? Are we doing things that are just a little bit too advanced because we saw it on this Instagram reel, or we saw it on this page that gets a lot of hits or whatnot, and it just looks cool? When I was younger, that's something that I did, but my frame of reference, because social media wasn't that strong at that time, 07, 08. So when I was younger, the thing that I was sort of guilty of when it came to doing more athletically advanced things, it was coming straight from the track for me. And so I was using a lot of track exercises and a lot of, you know, locomotive complex patterns and whatnot that would make a client work hard, but there wasn't too much to explain the why behind it, first and foremost. And second of all, it frustrated some clients because they couldn't get it right or perfectly, and they didn't understand how to move like that. And I didn't even realize that it took, you know, a number of years of doing it on my end to be good at it at that time as a 20-year-old. So it's just those kinds of ways to discern whether or not an exercise is useful for a client, whether an exercise is too advanced for a client, and whether a client even needs advanced, or if they need simple and doing simple well. And so that's a real shortcoming of mine at the beginning, and something that I do still see a lot of clients, or sorry, a lot of trainers who are younger doing. And there's probably a lot more access to that kind of content now than there used to be because of platforms that are on social media and whatnot. And so it's just important to cut through that sort of stuff and realize that there's a reason why people were able to build great athletic physiques or muscular or strong physiques or whatever it is you want to call it back in like the 70s, 50 years back, right? When we didn't have any of this stuff, and when most of that kind of training didn't even exist just yet. It's because the things that lasted the test of time until today in 2024 have always been those staple basic patterns that can't disservice you as long as you apply the right context to them.
And I think, yeah, you've highlighted something that's so important, that people tend to, especially if they're more inexperienced, tend to gravitate towards what they like or what they've done in their background, when it's not necessarily for all the reasons we've talked about, anthropometry, you know, all these sorts of things. It's not necessarily best for the client. And obviously, the most important thing is to do what's best for the client, right? So you mentioned it a little bit earlier in this sort of Instagram influencer type. I love that in your Instagram that you actually say not an influencer. And I think that's really refreshing and really important. And I mean, I suppose my question is, we see a lot of these personalities, and I say that advisedly in scare quotes, that, you know, first off, if Instagram died tomorrow, they probably wouldn't have much of a business. And second, the sort of, yeah, there's no longevity there, that they might be sort of, this is the latest, greatest thing, but it doesn't last. So as someone who's been in the industry for a long time, and you've just alluded to it there, what do you think the, you know, most important things are when training clients? What are the most important ways of retaining clients and all the sorts of things that you've mentioned there, and how to differentiate yourself from being, you know, one of these personalities?
Well, genuinely connecting with clients first and foremost. And, you know, I'm biasing this answer to training clients in person because that's what I do, and working with clients online or doing things virtually where I'm doing some kind of like a generic program where everybody can buy one copy of the program. I don't have a product like that, right? And I'd be very ambivalent toward creating a product like that because I like doing things custom. Even with the online clients that I have, you know, I have two handfuls of online clients. I don't have 50 clients or anything like that. And every client gets a program that I make for them based on my intake with them. And it's made by me from scratch. That's it, right? It's their program. And so I couldn't see myself saying, okay, you know what? Maybe one day, but I don't know. Well, here's a program that's fixed. Use at your own risk. It's on my website, and buy it for $100 and then try it, right? It would take a lot for me to go ahead and do that. So I'm not too sure whether or not it would happen. But anyway, when it comes to connecting with clients in person and retaining clients in person, of course, we touched on the importance of communication. Of course, we touched on how important it is to realize the human factor of a lot of this stuff. But I will add that one thing that I've been pretty good at this point, or to this point in my career, is making sure that you're available. It's as simple as that. And making sure that you don't keep dropping the ball in ways that are extremely controllable for you. For example, when did it happen? It happened, what is it? It's July right now. So it happened in May. Slept in on my 7 a.m. client, first client of the day. Slept in. Woke up at 7:15 to his phone call saying, you know, where are you at? And actually, it was to his, yeah, it was it a voicemail or a phone call? It was a voicemail. And I was like, so I woke up, I felt my phone vibrate, and I was like, oh, no. Listen, that probably happens to me once a year, right? So it's not like I'm a stranger to sleeping in on a client or to double booking a client. That happened last month. Two people came in at the same time, ready to train, thinking that there was a set time slot, and it was my fault. It wasn't theirs, right? So mistakes happen, and we're only human, and these kinds of things happen. But I'm not known for that by any stretch. This is not something that follows me around. This is a human mistake. But if you're somebody who over a 3-month span, every week you're no-showing on a client, every week you're double booking people, and you're not on top of that sort of thing, you don't have the organization, but on top of that, you're not reliable. That is a problem. And that's going to be something that is going to end your career very quickly, or at least lose your relationship with clients very quickly. You know, it's the worst thing possible to get fired as a trainer for reasons like that. Dropping the ball, that's no good. You know, get fired for something else. Get fired over a dispute over nickels and dimes. Get fired over, I don't think this is the right fit for me because of the style of training you use. Get fired for something else, but don't get fired for not showing up on time. Don't get fired for not being there for the client when the client is supposed to. Like, you know, those are the things that are, they're inexcusable in my case. So make sure that your groundwork is laid. Make sure your groundwork is taken care of. It's like eating your vegetables or brushing your teeth. You got to do that stuff, the fundamentals for you. If you can't show up, then that's going to really, really damage the remainder of your career. So if you're in the habit of being that way right now as a younger trainer or a younger coach, then try to curb that as soon as possible. Change your scheduled hours. Do whatever it takes. Go to bed earlier. You know, do confirmation calls, whatever it is that you have to do in order to fix those problems and get rid of those weak links. It'll happen, but it better not happen anything near often, and then you're going
to
be good.
I feel obliged to ask, and that's super useful stuff, but I feel obliged to ask, so what did you do when, so you see this voicemail at 7:15, and you're like, oh no, you know, I've screwed up here. Clearly, it's, as you said, by your own admission, your fault. How do you go about kind of recovering the position, and, you know, what did you do?
Well, here's the thing. That client I've been training now for 2 years, and that's actually one of the shorter duration clients that I've had, because a lot of my clients have been training for a long time, right? And so that client, I've been training for 2 years, and I didn't have to do anything. And that sounds horrible. That sounds ridiculously pompous, but let me explain. I didn't have to do anything. You know why? Because he has trained with me for 2 years at X amount of days per week for 7 a.m. sessions all through two, three times a week. Sometimes we even did four back in the day as well. I've got to get him back on four. Anyway, we've been training often, and I have never missed a single one, right? So when it's like that, and the track record speaks for itself, at that point, he's probably calling me not saying, oh, this guy's freaking no-showing on me. He's probably calling me saying, something must have happened, and that's what was up. Right. And so in that case, I say, hey, man, I'm so sorry. I just opened my eyes. I can't believe that I just fell. Like, no, no problem. Now, the other thing is, one reason why he came to me in the first place, and there's a lesson right in here, what I'm about to say. One reason why he came to me in the first place to train, it was right after the New Year's of 2022. Right. So I've been training him for 22 and 23. 22 and 23. So he contacted me. He was a referral from somebody else, and that person could not fit him into her schedule, and so she said, try training with Lee, that's a good trainer. And so he contacted me, and he told me about his experience in the past with training. You know, this guy said, you know, I'm a busy surgeon, I'm in my late 30s, I have a couple of issues that I want to work on, my back, my Achilles tendon, I've got stuff going on with my aorta as well, so a lot of stuff from a real, like, a clinical perspective. And he said, I trained with a trainer for years, probably a little bit years too long. And the reason why is because, man, we would train at 6 a.m. And like half the time I'd get no showed on. Half the time he wouldn't, I'd be coming to his place to work out. And half of the time, even when I'm at his door downstairs, I'm not getting a response because he's fast asleep type of thing. So he was coming to me from a point of dissatisfaction from his prior experience for a person who wasn't on the ball, who wasn't able to take care of those rudimentary things and, you know, brush the teeth and floss and do the basics that can make you a good service provider, right? Doesn't matter how much the guy knew. We didn't even get to that, right? But that was the lasting impression that was left, was that, you know what? I don't care. I just wanted somebody to motivate me and push me hard. I don't care how much you know. It's, can you show up, right? And so when that becomes the factor, not a good place to be, first of all, when that becomes the defining factor, but you know, there's a lesson in there for sure. You're gonna lose clients if you're not somebody who's taking care of those fundamentals, you know? So I call it brushing your teeth and whatnot. It just means showing up for work. It means being on time as well. If your session's at 7 a.m., you better be there at 7. You don't have to be there at 6:30, but you got to be there at 7, though. Don't be there at 7:08. Don't be there at 7:20. You know, those should be extreme one-offs where the person is eventually wondering if something happened, because this is by far not the norm. And it's funny because at that gym, when he was waiting for me, the next session, of course, I saw him. And then at the next session, he was like, yeah, so on Tuesday when you no-showed, when you were sleeping, I was at the gym. And so I went to the receptionist and I was like, have you seen Lee around? And she said, no. He was like, do you want to, you know, some kind of like you wanted to be taken care of somehow, right? Whatever it was. And he was like, no, listen, this is absolutely not like him. He's never done this once before, so it's okay. I'll just, and they're like, oh, okay, don't worry. Just do a workout anyway. Do your own thing. And yeah, and that was it. So it all went over quite well. And there was absolutely no ill feelings afterwards. The apology was there. And we picked it right back up the next session. And that's how it's been. So I always would advocate for trainers to be in the situation where, okay, we don't want this, but what we want is they're no-showing on you way more than you're no-showing on them. And it should always be that way, right? You should never, ever be on you. So just keeping that in mind and making a rule of it, you know, I hear my alarm, like you just react to it now. It's like, it's funny because I can sleep through a thunderstorm, but when I hear my alarm at 5:30 in the morning, it's not a nice soft alarm. Boom, your eyes are wide open. And that's how it goes.
Yeah, I think that, and that's, there's so many useful lessons in that. So even though it was a sort of negative, that there's so many kind of positives we can take from that. And it's very refreshing that you feel able to kind of share that sort of thing, as you said, because it's very much the exception and not the rule. So last kind of substantive question I wanted to talk to you about is longevity and training longevity. Now, I know it's going to be very related to all the stuff we kind of started off talking about, you know, picking exercises that suit your individual structure and being perhaps, you know, cognizant of different amounts of load and different, how different exercises are going to affect you differently from others and all that sort of stuff, and knowing your own body. So as someone who has had, and you had a pretty major injury, right? About six, seven years ago?
Yeah.
What are your sort of, I suppose, two questions? First off, tips for recovering from injury, and like major injury like that, not just, oh, you know, I've strained something and I got a week out. Like, you know, what I'd call a proper injury. And, you know, I suppose longevity tips, tips for kind of maintaining your ability to train over a long period.
The injury was a bilateral patellar tendon rupture, and that happened when I was 30 years old, so in 2017, and I was playing basketball. I was going up for a slam dunk, an alley-oop actually, and on my takeoff, they decided to just blow out on me. And so that was a six-month at least process in terms of getting kind of like reasonably functional again, where the first 3 months were spent in a wheelchair and you know, after surgery and all that. And so that process of coming back from major injury was a sort of a two-sided thing. On the one side, my admonition would be to get back into the gym as soon as possible so that you can train again and work out and get better. But I say that with a massive asterisk next to it, because on the other side of that coin, I will say, do not rush to get back into the gym as soon as possible. And the reason why, they're completely opposite statements, but what I mean by that is listen to your surgeon, listen to your doctors, and don't try to set the world record in terms of breaking through to new progressions in terms of how far you can go, how hard you can lift, how heavy you can lift, how much you can walk and all that stuff. That's not going to be useful for you. What's going to be useful is listening to your doctor. And when you get the clearance to do this, that, and the third, you take baby steps, but you get in there and you do it. Right. And so in the case of my training, after that was all said and done, I got the surgery and whatnot. I had surgery in May. I was able to get into the gym in July. That's when it was. I think it was, I was in a wheelchair from late April all the way through until, you know, June-ish something. So it was a couple of good months. And then by July, I was in these braces, range of motion braces. I was still wearing the braces when I was going to the gym. That's right. And so I did an upper body workout the first time, and I did box squats to the highest possible box, so I was barely bending my knees, and they were excruciating. And that was the extent of what I could do. And I was body weight, of course. And then by the next 2 weeks, I was able to take the braces down to 90-degree angles. And then after that, I was able to take them off as per the surgeon. And so then it was like, you know, you have little tweaks for legs and you're in pain and you can't bend past 90 with your tendons and whatnot. But you get in there and you do what you can, right? And I remember exactly what those workouts were. You know, I was using the Smith machine and trying to do some unloaded Romanian deadlifts. Excruciating. I was trying to use a stick, like a dowel, to use as sort of like a walking stick to help me with a low 1 foot box step up, and so on. These are on YouTube all somewhere, right? And so these kinds of exercises were the baby steps that I needed to A, get back into it and actually train my body, B, to help rehab, and C, to build confidence again, right? And that was a major factor for sure, is just to build that confidence up again that, hey, my lower body can do stuff. It's not going to be like, you know, I'm not going to be the same way for good. And I could now use something to gauge progress off of from week to week. I could do this, but last week I couldn't do this. So fantastic. I went from that Smith machine at the unloaded bar to an empty cradle trap bar to a high platform. So I did that. And then the empty cradle added 10 pounds to that cradle. And then, boom, I'm trap bar deadlifting 65. There it is, right? And so on and so forth. And so anyway, the confidence is huge. And the third reason why going back to the gym as soon as you can, within reason, is good to do is because I found that, I'll call it the osmosis effect, seeing people around that were all sort of working toward a common goal of getting better, getting in shape, getting in fit and training and working hard, that will change your mental state. That will increase your rate of change because of the psychological aspect that you're putting yourself through. There's all kinds of studies with athletes and with even medical professionals like practitioners, like chiropractic and things like that, where if there is a mental belief in something that you want to achieve, that you're going to get better results toward that goal. Right. And so, you know, if you have the desire and you want to win, then you're going to have a better chance of winning. If you're defeating yourself right out the gates, you're probably going to lose and not do too well. Right. And so even with a method of chiropractic or of certain practitioner stuff, if you believe in the method, this ART that this person is doing on my torn bicep, for example, if this ART, I believe that's what's going to help fix and heal me, it's going to increase the rate of change. And it's crazy to think, but this is stuff that's been actually put out there as research, which is crazy. So all that being said, being in the environment and having people around you that will help silently motivate you with behind the scenes really make you feel like, okay, I'm going to get back there. It's going to put you in a positive mind state and you're going to make better strides that way. And so that was a huge one for me. And that would be my other tip or my other piece of advice when it comes to rehabbing from injuries.
And I think that's really helpful from not just physiological, but psychological, all the stuff you've mentioned, like doing something, even if it's like you were a guy who deadlifted, whatever, 600 pounds, you know, everybody building it back up again, even if you have a goal and even if it's, you know, 10% of what you were lifting or whatever it would have been, still important that, you know, 65 and then, you know, it's a post-injury PR of 85, right? And that's still much better than it could have been and much better than it was.
But yep.
It says a lot to, you know, psychologically that must have been difficult to deal with. I can imagine I've had some injuries and, you know, psychologically, I think is the So it's interesting you went to the psychological piece, you know, to sort of explain.
The psychological side is huge, you know, and, you know, it could easily be a way to for you to get down because, you know, you're watching other people play the sport you were playing. For example, the NBA playoffs were on when I was getting injured, when I got hurt. So it was like, okay, now I got to watch this, right? And I can't really go anywhere either to get my head off of it. So you're just there. But the psychological aspect is a huge one to sort of control and regulate. And if you can get, you know, positive influences in whatever shape or form they could be. One thing that I love is movies as well. So that was a huge part of it for me too, is watching some good movies and whatnot. At least you get to enter a different world for a couple of hours, right? So even things like that can go a long way for people. So that psychological factor is one that is of such significance to not only just your mood and your approach to this, but also just your literal results when it comes down to it.
Yeah, and I think it's particularly important, and you've mentioned this before, even if your hobby is training and your profession is training, so obviously that makes an injury kind of doubly difficult to deal with, right? Because if you're a lawyer but you love training, it's like, okay, I can still do my job.
Yeah.
It's even harder in that respect. So I think it's very important for, even if you're incredibly passionate about training and you want it to be your career, but to have something else, right? As you said, for you, it might be movies, it might be sports, but to have some other, and that'll also help you, as you mentioned earlier, be a better trainer, because if all you can talk about is fitness and you have no idea about anything else in the world, as you said, you're missing a way in which you could potentially relate to clients, right?
Yep, 100%. I completely agree with that. And, you know, it was a learning experience for me in another vein as well, because now that I have firsthand experience an injury and a surgery and a recovery like that, it changes the game in terms of like how I'm going to approach working with a client who might have a history of that kind of stuff themselves, right? Maybe they didn't get the same injury, but okay, when they say they've got a bad back, now you have a different kind of respect for what that actually means, or what that might mean for you to, as workarounds, that is, right? In terms of what kinds of programming, what kinds of things you might do. So It's definitely a different perspective that it creates for a person.
Totally, yeah. And finally, on the sort of longevity piece that we've spoken about a bit before, but you've mentioned how your training has kind of evolved and how you can get away with a lot more at, you know, 25 than 35, for example.
Yeah.
What would be sort of, it's difficult, I appreciate it, but like 3 to 5 kind of key things that you'd have in your mind if someone at 25 said, I want to be able to train for the next 50 years, what would be the sort of 3 to 5 things that you'd say, well, be aware or be cognizant, think about these in your training?
The first one would definitely be, of course, your anthropometry and stuff like that. So think about your body type. The second thing that I would say would probably be, think about the fact, come to terms with the fact that your recovery and other factors are going to naturally change, probably for the worse. But it doesn't mean you can't still train heavy or hard. It just means that you have to train differently and more smart. And so it's like, count it as a real treat if you can hit a lifetime PR at this point in time. If you've been training for many, many years and now you're 40 and you're going to hit a lifetime PR on your deadlift or whatnot, and that's fantastic. But you shouldn't make your world revolve around those kinds of goals anymore. I just made a thing on Instagram that was saying about the 11 components of health and skill related fitness, right? And so strength is one that a lot of people in my game will think of as the one and only, right? And so strength accounts for a lot, but it's 1/11th of the things that we got to be focused on.
Yeah, not even 10%, right? Yeah.
Right. So, you know, power, speed, coordination, balance, agility, flexibility, cardiorespiratory capacity, muscular endurance, there's 8 right there. And those are just as important. And so if we've been focusing on just 1 or even 2 things in one shot and that's it, like how good is our balance? You know, one thing that goes on old people for sure is their lack of proprioception and balance and ability to create balance for themselves. And it sounds like something that's way too ridiculous to go and train, but that should occupy at least a portion of our training in a course of a year, that's for sure. How much time do we spend on one leg? How much time do we spend in locomotion? How much time do we spend focusing on our flexibility or mobility? how much time are we spending looking at things like our coordination or our reaction time, right? These are all things where we could probably find some holes in our training that we want to start actually addressing. And so, you know, I would think that just regarding those 11 components of health and fitness, like for me, especially when I was 30, it was just after the injury. By about 2020, 2019, 2020, I made more of a focus on incorporating a lot more cardiorespiratory and calisthenic, both of those things, getting into my training. So, you know, body weight staples, I wanted to start getting really good at that stuff, especially as a bigger dude. And second of all, cardiorespiratory capacity stuff. So I started doing cardio, and now I do cardio basically every workout, whether it's before, whether it's after. I got to get something in, even if it's an incline walk. If it's the assault bike, if it's the elliptical, if it's the Stairmaster, if it's the rowing machine, but I'm getting out there. I try every summer to get out there and do some sprinting, and I'm, you know, lucky enough to say that I've been able to get back to doing that since the injury, which is great. I'm proud of that, right? But neglecting your mobility or your flexibility wouldn't have been able to get me there, right? So all of those things, it's got to be a very holistic and very rounded approach toward your health and wellness. And if you don't do that, then you're going to probably run into some problems down the road, and the longevity is not going to be there. So training for servicing your body is important. And I guess second on the line for me would be training intuitively. So you're basically understanding that you know your body and you know what's good for it and what movements don't necessarily agree with it. You don't have to force feed anything. No one told you that you have to back squat. No one told you that you have to deadlift or even trap bar deadlift. That's a nice workaround, but no one told you have to do that either, right? So there's an answer for everyone that's going to suit that person. And if you don't do that lift, that's fine. Just don't do that lift and do something else.
Yeah. And I think what you said, first off, is a lot of people will be very competitive and sort of want to break records, but there's always some fitness quality to improve, right? Chances are, if you push strength for 15 years, you may have, as you said, neglected flexibility or cardiovascular training. And it's really interesting that you mentioned balance, because I interviewed, for example, Stu McGill, and he was very big on balance and arresting a fall and how that's incredibly important as you get older. And you really do lose that.
Yeah.
And then even someone like Dr. Peter Attia, right? He's talked about the importance of balance training and how, like, he's really focused on that. It's really interesting that you can always find something to kind of be a goal to keep you motivated, right? Even if it kind of changes a little bit over time. And I guess you've mentioned this before, but one of the benefits of training for a long time is that it's a lot easier to maintain certain qualities if you spent 15 years developing them. That strength's going to hang around much longer than if you'd only been training for a year, say.
Yep, 100%. You know, on that note as well, people have to recognize their training age, right? And so my training age, I guess I would have started training properly and seriously, let's say as a university student, let's say since I was, call it 18 years old, right? A lot of people who are 37 years old might have a training age of only 4 or 2 or 1, or maybe. And so with that being said, yes, you can pursue a lot of getting in the best shape of your life and the strongest you've ever been and so on. That's for sure. But 37-year-old body is different than 19-year-old body, who are both cases just getting started, right? There's so much more to consider when it comes to your rate of recovery, so much more to consider in terms of your stress levels, your responsibilities. Maybe you have had prior injuries even as a person who never lifted before. And possible, maybe you were in a car accident, who knows? But maybe you broke something when you fell out of a tree, whatever it is. These kinds of things can definitely affect and influence what your training should look like, especially as a mature adult who might be just getting into it. So the training age is a real factor, and also your not only rate of recovery, but your rate of change is probably going to be a little bit slower because of that too. When you're 18, you can look at weights and then go to McDonald's afterwards and just grow, right? And it's not quite like that now when you're twice that age or more. And so, you know, when you have somebody who's a beginning client, and be aware of that, especially if you're of an age that is younger than that of the client. So it's not coming from your own personal life experience, but you're at least knowledgeable and cognizant enough to recognize that this could be the situation, and treating that with care, it can go a really long way for people. So, you know, the training age thing, it matters a whole lot, and approaching things from a very pragmatic perspective can keep a client around. It can go far for you if you're the person who's getting started into it as well. and just recognizing that, you know, it's not as cut and dry as just, okay, well, I'm a beginner, so I'm going to learn the deadlift now, and that's it. Well, there's probably more things to think about first. And, you know, in a perfect world, we don't want people to be starting out their training journey when they're 40, but that's just the reality. And so we have to adapt to that.